All right, today let's look at some properties of noise in general. In particular, I want to look at a phenomenon called short noise, and we'd like to study the statistics of this because of the very large number of applications that such a process has. Now, to recall a few things to you, we looked at what a Poisson sequence did, Poisson pulse sequence did, namely, we said if you have a completely uncorrelated set of epochs or instants of time distributed according to a Poisson distribution, they form a Poisson sequence. And then some properties of this Poisson sequence we studied in connection with statistics. But now let's look at a more general version of this, and that's the following. So as a function of time, let's suppose that at random instants of time, you have an event occurring, a pulse occurring, like neuronal spikes from the brain activity or radio signals from outer space or whatever, some kind of random pulses appearing at random instants of time. The only proviso being for the moment that the times at which these pulses occur are completely uncorrelated with each other. So in general, you might have a signal that perhaps looks like this. There's a sudden spike and then it decays, and then a little later there's another one, etc. in this fashion. And these pulses occur at random instants of time. Let's call it ti, ti plus 1, ti plus 2, and so on. And it's assumed that this has been an ongoing process for a long time. Okay. Then the question one would like to ask is, what's the statistics? What kind of statistics does the stochastic process have corresponding to these signals that you detect? And let's suppose that these pulses occur at times t sub I, and let me call the shape of each pulse, let me call it f of t minus ti. That's the shape of the ith pulse, which starts at time ti and then goes on, decays. Could be finite duration, could go on forever, could exponentially decay, etc. We don't care. So the pulses, the shapes could actually overlap with each other. We don't care about that. But the starting instants are completely uncorrelated with each other. So the probability, so this sequence ti is a Poisson pulse. We'll assume that each pulse has a shape given by this function t minus ti. So this f of t is not is 0, could be taken to be 0 for t less than ti. Okay. Starts at ti and then it goes off in some fashion, compact or otherwise. Typical examples would be, for instance, if this is an exponentially decaying pulse with time, it could be of the form some e to the minus lambda t minus ti, multiplied by some height or whatever, but it's also multiplied by a step function t minus ti. That's one typical shape. Or it could be something which is a set of pulses which looks like this, and so on, rectangular pulses of some kind. So perhaps it's of the form theta of t minus ti minus theta of t minus ti minus tau, if tau is the duration of the pulse. This quantity is 0 everywhere except between this and that, the ith pulse, and that's it's given by this difference of theta functions, step functions. So we have in mind a signal psi of t. This is what is detected, and what you have is all these pulses getting detected. So this is equal to a summation from I, which could be from minus infinity to infinity. You might have an infinite train of these pulses, times f of t minus ti. And they could be of different heights. We don't care. So let's put a height variable there. Let's put h sub I. And the h sub i's could themselves be random, drawn from some independent distribution. Okay. So these are random pulse heights. You could generalize it even further and say even the shapes of these pulses could change over the pulses. We are assuming here for simplicity that the pulse is exactly the same shape. Each pulse is of the same shape. We have allowed for a little variation by changing its height, for instance. In the case of these rectangular pulses, for example, you could say even the duration of the ith pulse could be different from that of the jth pulse. So perhaps you have this I, and so on. So a lot of general possibilities occur, and the question is, what is the statistics of this xi, this process xi? Okay. What's the first order statistics? What's the power spectrum? What's the correlation function, and so on? This is what we'd like to find out. Okay. Now, if you go back a few steps, you realize that the way to get this at this process is to say, all right, let's first look at simply the Poisson process itself. Let's just look at something which is a every time there is a Ti, you add 1 to it, that is it. So that process, let me call it U of t equal to a summation from I equal to minus infinity to infinity theta function of t minus Ti. Okay. Now what does this process look like? Well, it is just a step. Every time there's a, it crosses one of the Ti's, it adds 1 to it and keeps going. So it's a staircase function that's increasing. Okay. So the first thing to do is to find the statistics of this, and then we find the statistics of successively of its derivative and so on and so forth. Now, what does its derivative look like? Let's call it x. So let's call x of t equal to u dot of t. And what does this look like? This is equal to d over dt of these theta functions over I theta over t minus ti. That is equal to summation over I delta of t minus ti. Okay. So you have a spike of unit strength, a delta function of unit strength at every instant ti. So what does this look like, this function? This thing simply looks like this. So every time there is a Ti, there is a spike, etc. So this is Ti, Ti plus 1, Ti plus 2, and so on. Okay. You could ask, what's the number of pulses up to time t? This number would be n of t. Would be the integral of this from minus infinity up to time t, because every time there is a delta function, it counts 1. Right? So this is simply equal to integral minus infinity up to time t dt prime, this guy. So summation over I delta of t minus t prime, and that counts precisely this. What's the rate at which these pulses are occurring? Well, that's the rate at which the original Poisson process is occurring, this pulse sequence. So let's give it a name. Let's say this is a Poisson pulse sequence with the mean rate nu. Okay. So the rate at which the pulses are occurring, that itself, then the number of pulses per unit time is itself a random variable. The mean rate, of course, is given to be nu. So that is clear from here that dn over dt, the derivative, is precisely delta of t minus ti. This is precisely your x of t. Because if I differentiate under the integral sign, this gives me a 1, and I put t prime equal to t, and I get just x of t. Okay. What's the average value of x of t? That's the rate at which the pulses are occurring. So the average value is nu. That's immediately clear, right? So Let's write that down. So it says x of t equal to nu. Is x of t a stationary stochastic process? Is this stationary? Because remember, the original pulse sequence is a Poisson process and nu is independent of time. That rate doesn't change with time. So the question, the way you decide whether a random variable is a stationary stochastic process or not, is to ask whether x of t and x of t plus constant have exactly the same statistics or not. Okay. And it's clear if I just add a constant to x of t, the statistics doesn't change at all, at any order. Right. So x of t is a stationary random process. Strictly stationary random process, because we have random processes which are strictly stationary, which means the statistical properties simply don't change. None of the distributions changes when you have a constant added to the random variable, or wide sense stationary, which means that the mean value is independent of time and the 2-point correlation is a function of the time difference alone. But higher order correlations might not be so. This is strictly stationary. This process is strictly stationary here. And this quantity, x of 0, x of t, this guy here, can be computed. I'm going to leave this as an exercise to you and tell you how to do this, give you a hint and tell you how to do this. You can actually compute the autocorrelation of this process. Okay. And this turns out to be nu times delta function at t plus nu squared. Now, a word about how you actually compute autocorrelations of these of stationary processes. First of all, if a process is stationary, its derivatives are stationary and so on and so forth. Now, the way to do this is if you give me a correlation, let me just call the random variable xi for the moment, so that, so if xi of t has a correlation function, let's call this correlation function, I use a symbol for it, right, I use c for it, c, but you got to be careful, there could be a mean value. If this xi doesn't have a zero mean, but has a non-zero mean, then the correct way to define the covariance of this object is delta xi of 0 delta xi of t, as you know, right? So let me write this down. If average value of xi equal to mu is not equal to 0, then the correlation, a covariance, it's called the covariance, equal to delta xi of 0 delta xi of t, which is equal to this quantity xi of 0 xi of t minus mu squared, the average value. We know that over and over again, we've gone through this. And we define the power spectrum as the Fourier transform of this fellow here. That's not the same as the, this is the correlation function. And that's the covariance function. So I need a slight change of notation, got to be a little careful. So let's call this C of t, and let's call this R of t. That's the standard notation in books on random processes. So C of t and R of t are slightly different objects. They just differ by this guy here, always. Now, the way to do this is the following. If you have a stationary process, then R of xi, well, let's be even more careful. This is R xi of t. That means it's the correlation of xi at time 0 with xi at time t, right? Then the first step is xi dot So the correlation of xi of 0 with xi dot of t, this guy here is equal to minus d over dt r xi xi, and r xi dot equal to minus d2 over dt2 r xi xi. So you got to differentiate each time, which is why when you do the power spectrum, you multiply by omega, by I omega each time. Okay. So let's not get into this thing here, but let me just point out that to find this result for the delta function sum, the sum of delta functions, you start with the theta functions and find its autocorrelation. And that's easier to do. And once you do that, twice differentiating it will give you this. Okay. So I'm going to leave this to you as an exercise. You must remember that the derivative of a theta function is a delta function. You need to remember that. That's where this comes, will turn out to come from. Okay. So whatever, let's take this result. It's easy enough to establish. So let's take this as our basic result. And then what do we add, want to add on to this? You see, now I'm going to simply motivate it heuristically. We can go through the derivations, but it's not particularly enlightening. The result is very clear. We want the autocorrelation, we want of xi of 0, xi of t, this guy here, what this implies. But before that, let's write the power spectrum of this fellow out. So this is S x. Again, let's use proper notation. Both are x. This guy here is a Fourier transform. It's simply 1 over 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity dt e to the I omega t of this. So this fellow will give me nu over 2 pi plus, what does this give me? Yeah? It gives me a delta function of omega, right? Because it's just 1 over 2 pi e to the I omega t minus infinity to infinity, and that's a delta function. That's the power spectrum. We have the autocorrelation. Now the question is, what is the autocorrelation of xi given that of x? Okay. And one can sort of guess what it's going to be. In fact, let's guess what the average value of xi of t is going to be. I define xi of t in this fashion, yeah? And we want to know what is its average going to be. This is an independent random variable, so this average is going to come out when you take averages, and then you need to take the average over the random variable ti. So it's clear that somewhere along the line you're going to get an integral of this, because we want the average value of this f, but now we appeal to ergodicity. Namely, you take the time average of f, and that's going to be the ensemble average. Okay. So there's definitely going to be, and then it's multiplied by the rate at which these fellows happen, because the average for the process x of t is itself nu. So there's definitely going to be a nu, and then there's going to be an average of h, this, multiplied by minus infinity to infinity dt f of t. Okay. Now, of course, remember that f of t might be 0 up to t equal to some given value, some say 0, and then it drops down in this fashion. So this integral is formal. It's not going to run up to minus infinity, because a pulse starts at some point. And I said you could define f to be 0 for negative values of its argument. And that's it. That's the average value of xi. Okay. What's the variance of xi going to be? This is xi squared, average squared. And this is equal to, and now this is a non-trivial statement. It's definitely going to involve the rate nu, because it's all controlled by this guy, by this process. And then we want the square of this fellow here, and then you want this function squared inside. Okay. So this is equal to, and this is a non-trivial result, it's nu times h squared times integral minus infinity to infinity dt f of t, and it's squared inside. This requires proving. This is not a trivial statement. And together, these statements are called Campbell's theorem. Okay. But physically, it's very clear where these terms come from, and so on. In particular, the fact that nu appears here multiplicatively outside in all of them. Okay. In fact, there is an extension of Campbell's theorem to the case when this function f itself has to be ensembled averaged. The shape itself might be different and so on. And there is a further, there is another extension of this even in this case to the higher cumulants. It turns out that if Kn is the nth cumulant, of xi, then Kn turns out to be nu times h to the n inside there, and then minus infinity to infinity dt f of t to the power n. It's quite a remarkable thing that that's all it is. You can write down the full statistics of this xi. We've still not come to the point of what is its correlation. It's a stationary process, so all these averages are time independent explicitly. They're all single time averages. This is independent of time. This guy here. So we have complete first order statistics here by Campbell's theorem and its extension. Okay. On the other hand, the fact that you know what this fellow is, what the power spectrum is for x, also tells you what the power spectrum is for xi itself. Okay. And this implies that the power spectrum of xi, and let me write it as xi xi of omega, this is equal to, now it depends on the Fourier transform conventions, but let me be careful here. This is there's a 2 pi f tilde of omega mod squared. You would expect that because this f is going to appear everywhere, and it's got to be quadratic because it's a power spectrum. There are going to be two of these fellows, psi is multiplying each other, times 2 nu average value of h, that's what this is going to give me, and it comes from this term, plus 4 pi nu squared, this is average value of h squared, and then this is h squared delta of omega, that comes from here. And this goes by another theorem, which is familiar to electrical engineers. What's this called? Well, the one for the mean and the variance are called Campbell's theorem, and this one is called Carson's . This term, as you can explicitly see, arises, there is a weight here at delta, there is a delta function at omega equal to 0, there is a DC contribution coming entirely from the fact that the average value of h may not be 0. If that is 0, this is gone. Okay. By the way, what is the power spectrum for the process which is again controlled by a pulse process, Poisson pulse process, but where the variable takes just two values, say plus 1 or minus 1 or plus C and minus C, the dichotomous Markov process. What's the power spectrum going to be for that? So in that case, you have a process xi of t equal to plus or minus C, and it goes like this. Etc. With a rate which has got to be prescribed to you in some fashion. So the rate, we use the symbol lambda for it, but let us use nu for it now. Because these things here are controlled by a Poisson process, assuming that both the down to up and up to down to transitions are controlled by the same Poisson process. Okay. So we know that xi of 0, xi of t equal to c squared e to the minus 2 nu t, 2 nu modulus t in this case. So for t greater than 0, it is exponentially correlated. What is the power spectrum therefore? C squared over 2 pi. And then the Fourier transform e to the I omega t, etc. So there was a twice we could do the cos omega t by integrating 0 to infinity. So we have 0 to infinity dt e to the minus 2 nu t cos omega t. And what does that give you? This is equal to 2 nu c squared. It's Lorentzian. Okay. This is Lorentzian in this case. So we can plug in all kinds of functional forms here and see what this looks like. The power spectrum of this noise looks like now. Once you have this theorem in place, that's it. I mean, let's look at the simplest instance. This is a short noise, the original short noise, right? Now. The whole thing, I should have titled the whole thing short noise, because it is general short noise in general. That means a set of pulses of some kind, uncorrelated with each other. That was our assumption. But the original short noise was the noise which was seen when you had these electrons coming out of a cathode in some electronic tube. You collected the current and you discovered the current went up in spikes. Every time an electron hit the collector, you got a spike. Right? It was just pure delta function spikes in the simplest case. So it is essentially our process x of t, essentially, except that each time you had a charge and therefore there was a current. And what's the power spectrum of this going to be in this case? So if your rate of at which things were happening was your x of t process, s x x of t of omega was equal to, we wrote this down somewhere, there was a nu apart from the 2 pi factor, etc., etc., and then there was a plus a nu squared delta of omega, right? So let us look at it for omega greater than 0, it was essentially this. And then if you put in, there was a factor 2, this in the engineering convention of doing things, and h was 1 in that case. So it was basically 2 nu, because this fellow here was 1, the shape was 1 inside. So it became 2 nu, and then therefore it was 2 e squared nu, that is it. But this is equal to twice E times E nu, but that is the average current, because the rate at which these electrons are coming in is nu, and E times nu is the rate, is the current, average current. This was the original short noise. Proportional to E and not proportional to the temperature, whereas we saw that for white noise you had a temperature factor. So this was the way in which they could distinguish the two kinds of noise. This was noise was independent of temperature. What happens if you have a square pulse? So let's do that. Incidentally, one can write this formula a little more simply in the following way. So let's write that down a little more simply. We'll use the fact that xi squared average, xi average equal to nu times average of h, yeah, times an integral minus infinity to infinity dt f of t. But we know that 2 pi f tilde of omega was the integral e to the I omega t times f of t. So f tilde of 0 is this integral. So we have xi equal to nu average h xi 2 pi nu average h f tilde of 0. So this squared is, let's write this as 2 pi f tilde of 0 whole squared nu squared h squared in this fashion. So this thing here becomes 2 pi f tilde of omega whole squared, and then there is a 2 nu h squared plus 2 pi. By the way, once I multiply by delta of omega, I could write this as f tilde of 0. Right? So we have 2 pi f tilde of 0 whole squared, and then 4 pi squared so the nu squared is there, h squared is there, and then 2 pi this guy is there, right? So this is equal to 4 pi average xi whole squared delta omega. A little more convenient to write it like this in terms of the average of xi itself. Okay. Look at what happens for a square pulse. This is a very, very common situation. So f of t minus ti is this guy, and let's take the pulses to have the same. So what's f tilde of omega? Is 1 over 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity blah blah. Or let's find 2 pi f tilde of omega. 2 pi this guy equal to an integral from 0 to tau dt e to the I omega t times 1 pulse of unit height, a theta function, right? So this is equal to e to the I omega tau minus 1 over I omega. So we need this fellow here, mod squared. We need mod squared of this. This is equal to, I pull out an e to the I omega tau over 2, and then I get mod squared, that goes away, and then I'm going to get 2 sin omega tau over 2 over omega. So this becomes 4 sine squared omega tau 2 omega squared. It's the sinc function squared, right? And you plug that in here. So for the case of square pulses, S xi xi of omega for square pulses, rectangular pulses, is equal to, apart from various constants and so on, for omega greater than 0, let us forget the DC contribution, it is proportional to nu times sine squared omega tau over 2 over omega squared. Okay. So that is a very, very typical result. What happens if the taus themselves varied randomly? Oh, by the way, in general, of course, it's nu times h squared here. What happens if the taus themselves varied randomly and independently? Well, the only place tau appears is here. So it just gets averaged. I mean, there's further average over whatever distribution you care to prescribe, generally with the cutoff between some lower and upper range, some window of taus, continuous window, distributed in some fashion, and you can find what its average is. Okay. So let us look at another example, a very simple example, a physical one. If you take a piece of iron and you magnetize it, you apply a magnetic field and you jack up the field as you go along, then you discover that domains inside this piece of iron start orienting in the direction of the field, and they do so at random. So every time it does so, the magnetization changes by a small amount. So in the simplest instance, let us assume the magnets were pointing in one direction, and under the field in the upward direction they orient upwards, right? So the change in magnetization is going to be of the form twice. So if it runs from, if there is a little domain with magnetization M pointing down, and then it points up, the same domain points up, then the change in the flux magnetization is 2M, and this change in flux will die down exponentially. Okay. So there is some 2M e to the minus t over tau. This is what the flux will look like. Okay. And now, if you detect this, this flux will induce a current in a coil, and then that current can be used to drive a loudspeaker and you can actually hear it. It is called Barkhausen noise. So what is the rate of change of flux? And that is what the voltage is going to be, the random voltage. So V of t is going to be 2m, the derivative of this, which is going to be tau e to the minus t over tau with a minus sign. That is what Faraday's law of induction says. And if you got a coil with n turns, there is going to be an n. So that is going to be the random voltage that occurs if there is a change of domain at time t equal to 0. This is your f of t, the pulse shape, right? So what is the correlation going to be now? What is the power spectrum going to be? It is essentially like, you have to take this quantity and take its transform, right? That is it. F tilde of omega. So what is F tilde going to be for this guy? This is for t greater than 0. So what is F tilde of omega going to be? And what is its modulus going to look like? Lorentzian. Again, it is just going to be Lorentzian. Okay. So this will imply that S V V Szi of omega is proportional to, once again, nu is going to sit there, and then there's going to be 1 plus omega squared tau squared, apart from some constants. Just going to be a Lorentzian shape. Okay. And you can measure it explicitly. So this formalism, these two theorems, Campbell's theorem and Carson's theorem, are actually very, very powerful. As long as the pulse sequence is uncorrelated, you can get fairly simple closed form answers for the power spectrum, assuming the process is stationary, and of course the original uncorrelated assumption. Now it gets more and more intricate when things get correlated to each other, and some results are available for the case where the height is, say, the correlated with the width of the pulse and so on. But that's a secondary problem. That's a separate problem altogether. Okay. So I thought I'd mention this simply to round off the fact that in practical situations, you measure the power spectrum directly, and there are these two theorems which help you understand what a pulse sequence would do. Okay. The interesting problems arise in correlated pulses, when you have pulses which are not independent of each other. In other words, you don't have a Poisson process, then you have a much more complicated situation, and I'll make some comments about that a little later. Okay. So let's now move on to a class of processes which go beyond the Markov process. So let's look at some non-Markovian processes. And what's the simplest such process we should look at? Well, there are several ways to approach this, but since we've been doing a lot of diffusion, let's take a problem which involves diffusion itself and ask what happens if I have a position variable for a diffusing particle which will obey a non-Markov process, which will be a non-Markovian process. Okay? And here's the way one does it. You know that the simplest model of diffusion for a particle on a line, such that its probability density obeys the diffusion equation, was in fact as the integral of white noise. So we said x dot equal to square root of 2d times, this is Gaussian white noise. And then immediately we got a process which was Markovian but not stationary. We discovered that x of t, the displacement starting from 0 say, is 2d integral 0 to t dt prime eta of t prime, and this was the Wiener process out here. We call that the Wiener process. Okay. And we found out what the correlation of this was, the average value. We found x of t prime average equal to 2d minimum t prime, and so on. So this diffusion process, the position was the integral of white noise. Now I say, all right, and we also saw that white noise came about, I mean, we saw that this process came about as the continuum limit of a particle undergoing a random walk on a line in which the step length went to 0 and the time between steps went to, the time step also went to 0, such that a squared over 2 tau went to the finite limit d. So it was a limit of a simple random walk where the walker tossed a coin and with equal probability took a step to the right or a step to the left, and we took a limit. We said that the step length, so this is a continuum limit of a simple random walk in which a squared over tau went to twice b. We also accommodated bias diffusion here by saying that there is a probability of moving to the right or left were different, p and q, etc. That led to a diffusion equation with a drift term present which took into account the fact that you had a constant force such as gravity. Right? So that should be clear that the simple random walk in the unbiased case gave you unbiased diffusion, gave you this unbiased diffusion limit, and the biased random walk gave you a diffusion with drift, as if you had a constant force present, right? But in both cases, the X process was the integral of white noise, Gaussian white noise. Okay. Now you could say, well, suppose this particle should also have some memory of its momentum. We are now looking at the process saying that, well, the position alone is not enough to describe the state of the particle. You should know its position and velocity at any instant of time, or position and momentum. Now, what would be the discrete way of looking at of implementing this is to say, well, the walker moves to the right or left with different probabilities depending on the direction in which he was moving in the previous step. So, with probability p, he continues in the same direction that he was moving, either to the right or left, and with probability q, he reverses direction. Okay. Now, what is the effect of this? It means there is memory in the process. The walker is remembering where he came from in the previous step. So, it immediately tells you this cannot be a Markov process at once. There is some memory, right? Earlier, the person was just tossing a coin and saying p, with probability p I move to the right, probability q I move to the left, and you do this at each site. And now you say, all right, I now move to the right or left with I now continue in the same direction or reverse direction with probabilities p and q respectively. Right? So, I remember where I came from in the previous step. I can write difference equations for this process also. And what would happen in the continuum limit? It would be correspond to saying that the walker remembers the direction of motion. And now if you say that the drift velocity is constant in a suitable limit, we can show immediately that the velocity of the particle is constant. Then it is equivalent to saying that a particle is diffusing with velocity either plus c or minus c. And there is a certain average rate at which the particle changes direction, right? Then let us write down what the master equations could be for this process. So, I am going to skip going through the discrete and going to the continuum, we will write down the continuum immediately. So, now instead of saying p of x comma t is the probability density of this particle at any given time t, right? I should also tell you the state of the particle by saying what is the direction of the velocity, is it moving towards the right or is it moving towards the left, right? So, there is a PR and a PL of x comma t, right? And I need to write down rate equations for PR and PL together, right? And that is done very simply, there are only two states, R and L for each x. So, this is like saying I am writing down probability densities for p x v t, except that I am saying v is plus or minus c. That is all I am doing, right? And what do you call a process in which you have a plus c and a minus c, and that is a Markov process? It is a dichotomous Markov process. So, it is essentially saying that this velocity process is a dichotomous Markov process. So, this is dmp, and the position is the integral of the velocity, right. So, we are saying x dot equal to v, and this fellow here is a dmp. With some correlation time. So, if the reversals are occurring with a mean rate nu, for instance, then this process we are guaranteed that v of 0, v of t in this problem, this can only have the values plus or minus c, and it is a dichotomous Markov process. The mean value of the velocity is 0. So, this must be equal to c squared e to the minus 2 nu mod t. And now we are asking a hard question. We are saying, what about the integral of a dichotomous Markov process? Just as we looked at the integral of white noise and we got a Wiener process, Now we are asking, what's the integral of a dichotomous Markov process which has a finite correlation time? So what kind of correlation time does this have? It turns out the problem is now non-Markovian, okay, because X, this process X, is not a Markov process. On the other hand, the combined process X together with V is a two-dimensional Markov process, okay. But let's write the equations down for this and you'll immediately see where this is taking us. What's dP R over dT of X comma T equal to? What can this be equal to? Well, there's a gain term and a loss term, right? So, if at rate nu you change from L to R, so there's going to be nu times PL of XT, but you're also going to lose the fact that you're going to switch out to the other state, so this is minus PR of X comma T. You should actually write this as PR of XT plus delta T and put the delta T's outside there and so on. So with probability nu delta T, you're going to actually reverse direction. And that's going to, if you go from L to R, that's a gain for R. If you go from R to L, that's a loss for R. And this is PL of XT over DT equal to nu times PR of XT and that's it, right? But these are derivatives with respect to time, total derivatives, right? So what's the partial derivative equal to? XT plus the convective derivative V dot del, but V is plus C in this state. And that's equal to so that's your equation, okay. And similarly, this equation now becomes delta PL delta T XT minus C delta PL X. These are the equations for this problem and this is called persistent diffusion or correlated diffusion. So our task now is to solve these equations. What would you expect will happen if I eliminate PR or PL in favor of the other probability and write an equation for PR alone? You get a second order equation in time, which means that your initial condition has to be specified for both PR and PL. That's equivalent to saying you're specifying the initial position as well as the velocity, whether it's plus C or minus C. So it's non-Markov. The X process alone is non-Markov. But the combined process is Markov. The X comma V process is Markov and they satisfy these two equations. So our next task is to solve these two guys, okay, which we will do, write down the solution. They look reasonably trivial, but it's not all that trivial, but they've got many interesting properties. We'll see what this process does in detail. But this is the physical motivation. The original physical motivation, this was introduced by G.I. Taylor, And his original motivation was to introduce momentum into the problem, because he had the hope of understanding turbulence using this. Of course, that's not true. But this process, persistent diffusion itself, is very important in something called dispersion in fluid layers, and we'll talk about that subsequently. Okay. Now, these two are also called the telegrapher's equation for a reason I'll explain. The first thing you observe is that if you add these two guys, the right hand side vanishes. So that's one simplification, but then you have to be careful, there's a minus sign here. So it doesn't immediately give you the solution, etc. On the other hand, you have a little bit of simplification, they're first order equations. So we could perhaps use a matrix method to try to solve this. On the other hand, you eliminate one of the variables, you're going to get a second order equation, and then you should have to deal with that. But it will have the advantage that there'll be a second derivative in space and a second derivative in time. So it looks like, you know, you can use a little bit of homogeneity property here. Okay. Would you expect this to have diffusive behavior? Would you expect the mean square displacement to increase like time?
Second order
in both space and time. So it's not immediately clear what's going to happen. It does, you do see that the mean square velocity is c squared. So it looks like there might be ballistic motion. So the mean square displacement may actually increase like the square of the time. Okay. On the other hand, it's not immediately obvious what will happen as t becomes very, very large, because you do expect the central limit theorem to start operating, right? So we'll see what happens.